Good night, Facebook. It is once again my pleasure to be with you. Let me make sure this volume is up, because I was told the last time that the volume was kind of low. So I'm going to turn it up at the max here. And I think we should be good and ready to go. Okay, there we go. Good night, Facebook. It's once again a pleasure to be with you on this other episode of our teaching. Now tonight, we're going to be going extremely deep into teaching. And our teaching tonight is the mystery behind fasting. Now, I know that there aren't much people that teach on fasting, and whatever is taught is basically surface. So tonight, I would strongly advise that you get your notepads, your pens, your pencils, and along with that, get some scuba gear, because we're going extremely deep tonight into this teaching. As always, my teachings are to not just inform you of what you're up against on your Christian walk, or as it relates to the invisible world, which we call the spiritual world, but to also prepare you, to equip you to now break the cycle of failure, the cycle of defeat, the cycle of generational curses and hardship and difficulties and the spirit of poverty and anxiety, attack, all of these things. And then they are all curses, and they come about through ignorance. So my teaching is to take you behind the scenes of these things. And in doing that, you now begin to deal with the root causes of the difficulties that's going on in your life. Now, before we get into tonight's teaching, there are two things that I want to address prior to getting into the teaching. The first one is emails. I say to you all the time, I get hundreds, literally, especially since I've been doing the videos, my emails have been tremendously enormous. So if I don't get to you right away, it isn't that I'm ignoring your email. It's only one of me. And I have to put emphasis on that, because there are some people who behave as if they pay me, okay? And I'm not trying to be rude, I'm not trying to be difficult, but what I would like for you to do, though, is to be considerate. You know, I interpret dreams as a courtesy, you know? So when I get to it, I will interpret it for you. But I'm just asking you to be patient. And more importantly, though, the truth is, you know what? You really don't need an interpretation from me, you know? You know, I direct you to my webpage or my blog site, all right? I post it every now and again, kevinlaewing.blogspot.com. I have over 500 articles, over 500. Oh, listen to this carefully, over 500 articles I've written. More than 140 of those articles are about dreams. So a lot of you are writing me for certain interpretation, and I have taught extensively on it, whether it's by video or whether it's written article material, and I go into detail. So the reality is, if you go on my blog site, and I have everything in alphabetical order, just look to the right-hand side, you scroll down the blog site, and you're going to see the section in dreams. Jim, just click on that. You click on that, you read all the stuff on there. You go down all the way to the bottom to get on the next page. You're going to see something says, whatever it is, it means you just click it and it'll take you to the next page. So while you're waiting on me to interpret your dreams, I encourage you to go on my blog site, kevinlaewing.blogspot.com. I will be posting that blog site right after this recording. And I encourage you. I mean, it's free resources. It took me years to write. I was writing since 2009 to compile all that stuff. And as I write them, I just have them sent to my blog site. So please go to the blog site, read the articles on dreams. I mean, I have hundreds of other articles there, but most of the emails that I get, you know, people want me to interpret dreams for them. And I'm saying too, prior to me getting there, because it probably might take me a while to get there, because I literally have, I'm sure I have over 1,000 emails right now that has yet to be opened. So I'm asking you to go to the blog site, scroll down under the alphabetical topics, look under dreams, click on dreams. There I have 140 plus articles on dreams. You know, I went out of my way to make sure you would have the resources. For those of you that do not like to read, I admonish you to go to my YouTube channel where you can watch all of these videos. Every time I post something here on Facebook, live recording, I have a transfer to YouTube. That's Kevin L.A. Ewing. Once you go to YouTube, you type in Kevin L.A. Ewing, and it's going to pull up all of my articles. Sorry, all of my videos. Now, my videos, because I've just started doing them, aren't as extensive as my articles. So I encourage you to use these free resources, because one day they ain't gonna be free no more. One day you have to pay. So I'm asking you to take full advantage. One more thing I want to cover before I get into this teaching. Now, I know some of you are kind of caught on to this spiritual father and spiritual mother business, right? So I can be real with you. I have major issues with that, all right? My name is Kevin. Some people call me Minister Kevin. It don't matter. You know, if you call me by my first name, last name, it doesn't matter to me. I don't care, because it's titles don't move me. The anointing grabs my attention. But while I don't like titles, please don't ever in this life call me a spiritual father. I am not your spiritual father. God is your spiritual father. Now, some of you may have issues with that. Well, take it up with whoever. But please, don't address me as your spiritual father. I don't believe in that stuff. That's me. That's me personally. So to avoid any further discussions on this, you could write me, hey, Kev. You call me Kev. I have a problem with Kev, Kevin, K. Some call me Minister K. I have zero problem with that. Just don't ever address me as your spiritual dad, pops, spiritual daddy. Don't call me none of those things, because I will not answer you. I will not respond to you. No offense to you. I don't believe in that. The only spiritual father that Kevin has is the God above. I don't address nobody else as no spiritual father. Okay, with that out of the way, I want us to get into our teaching tonight. And again, our teaching is on the mystery behind fasting. This was a teaching I was supposed to do from 2 weeks ago, but my schedule wouldn't allow me to. I have a lot going on, a lot, but I'm very much dedicated to what I do because I love it. I have an extreme passion for what I do. I love to teach. I love exploring the Word of God. I'm obsessed with sharing it with people like yourselves, my viewers. And the idea is to break the band of ignorance, which has kept so many of us in bondage for so many years. So many churches that we go to, when we went there for freedom, they added another set of shackles on us. And we had to dance to their beat in terms of following their protocols and what pleases the pastor and how we must do this and that. And very little emphasis is placed on the laws and principles of God. My teaching is to destroy that foolishness, to bring to an end that nonsense, and to just drive you to the Word of God. Okay, so let's get into this teaching tonight. There's a story in the Bible where there was this man, and he had a son, and the son was having some serious challenges. And one of the challenges that he had a lunatic spirit, to the extent that the boy would literally throw himself into the burning fire flames and would do things that was not becoming of him. The father realized that there was something terribly wrong with his son. And based on the scripture that we're going to go to, it will also indicate to us that this young man wasn't always this way. So clearly something went down that would have caused this boy to behave in a manner that was not becoming of him. The father, in his desperation to bring some relief to his son, or to have his son restored to his original, decided to take his son to the disciples, because he realized that, you know, these guys are into the spiritual business and so on, And clearly he realized that what was going on with his son was not physical, meaning that he's obviously exhausted the services of the learned practitioners of medicine, doctors. And he said, let me take him to, because even this guy, who the Bible does not label as a spiritual man, but even he knew that if his son could not be cured physically, want you to hear this now, then clearly what was happening to his son must have been spiritual. So he took his son to his to the disciples of Jesus and asked them to heal him or rid him of whatever was going on with him. And unfortunately, the disciples were not able to do it. So this man, in his desperation, then took his boy with much complaint to Jesus. And he said, listen, I've had my son to your disciples, your students, to rid him of what's going on with him. And they failed. Long story short, Jesus delivered the boy. The mystery in this story is, what did Jesus do that the disciples could not do in terms of healing this young man? I mean, after all, Jesus is their teacher. So the reality is, in our everyday world, we would look at this as a bad reflection on the teacher, because if you've been sitting under this person for X, Y, Z, and none of you, not even one of you, could perform what he did in terms of miracles, then more than likely we would look at the head or the teacher and see, what is it that you're teaching these people? So I want us to get into the story, and you're going to find this story in Matthew chapter 17 and beginning at verse 14, right? Again, I hope you have your pen, I hope you have your paper. We're going to go extremely deep tonight. You're going to learn the mystery. In fact, you're going to learn stuff about fasting you've never heard before. So it's about revelation to advance you. Matthew chapter 17 verse 14 says, and when they were come to the multitude, there came to him a certain man kneeling down to him and saying, listen to verse 15, Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a lunatic. He crazy, his head ain't no good. And sore vexed, he's mad. For many times my son throws himself into the fire, and oftentimes he tries to drown himself. Now that isn't sensible behavior. But before we go any further, I want to point out something here just to give you some revelation in that small piece of verse 15. The man described his son as being a lunatic or having a lunatic spirit. And that word luna comes from the Latin word luna, which means moon. Now, in my study of that particular verse alone, which is the 15th verse of Matthew 17, basically what that part of the scripture is saying, that someone did this to this boy. Someone worked something on him, something spiritual, witchcraft. And the type of witchcraft that they use was the Bible warned about worshiping the moon and the sun and so on, and drawing powers from it to bewitch other people. And as a result of that, this boy became mad. He became crazy. He was operating on five. Verse 16 says, and I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. So clearly, whatever was going on with this boy was so strong, so powerful, the disciples, and this is serious, the disciples could not heal him. The disciples could not sort him out. Verse 70 says, then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer or allow you? Bring this boy to me. Verse 18, and Jesus rebuked the devil. Hold on, back up now. Back up. I'm kind of confused here, because when we go back to verse 15, it clearly dictates the man said the boy was a lunatic. And the boy was mad. He was so vexed. He was so angry. He was so perturbed that when he sees some fire burning somewhere, he throws himself into the fire. And if they had cars back then on a highway, and if he was standing on that highway, more than likely he would throw himself in the car, on the path of the car. So clearly, there was something wrong. But when Jesus brought the boy, Jesus said, bring this boy. And it says, and Jesus rebuked, listen carefully in verse 18. He did not rebuke the boy. I want you to hear this now. Jesus rebuked the devil. How did the devil get in this? Because I'm hearing about the man. I'm hearing about his son. That's two parties. I'm hearing about the disciples at the third party. And I'm hearing about Jesus, which is the fourth party. But when we drop to verse 18, it says that when Jesus began his rebuking, he did not rebuke the boy who was a lunatic. Instead, it says that Jesus rebuked the devil, and he, which is the devil, departed out of him. So, this lunatic spirit that had this boy doing things that he didn't want to do, the same spirit that had him mad and angry with the world, walking around upset and vexed all day, this was as a result of a devil, of a demon, that based on that lunatic word, came about through evil powers. Therefore, through this evil powers, through this spirit of witchcraft, Jesus said, bring him here, and Jesus rebuked the boy. Long story short, the disciples was confused because they wanted to know how come they could not do this. So they pulled Jesus to the side and they said, well, Master, how come we couldn't do it? But let's drop down to verse 21. Verse 21 of Matthew chapter 17 now gives us a revelation. And listen to this revelation. It has everything to do with tonight. The revelation says, Jesus responding now, this is in red, howbeit or however, this, and I want you to circle this word, kind, K-I-N-D, circle that word. This kind goeth out or will not be removed outside of prayer and fasting. Now let's get into this tonight. Jesus is saying that your regular prayer will not move certain devils. Your regular prayer will not remove certain problems. Your regular prayer, depending on the ups and downs in your marriage, will not fix your marriage. Your regular prayer, depending on the state of the curse of poverty on your life, will not address your poverty problem. Jesus said this kind, that word circle it, the word kind, speaks of a higher order, a different level, a greater class. In so much words, he's not dealing with your regular devils, your regular demons, your regular evil spirits. These are evil spirits. These are demonic forces that are on a higher level, which is going to require a greater spiritual method to have them removed. And he gave the revelation of that method. And he says here in Matthew 17 and 21, he says, listen, boys, this type of evil entity will only come out through prayer and fasting. There are many of you watching me right now, and you're shaking your head and said, my God, what he's saying is true. Because for years you've been praying over a situation. Your pastor prayed, the evangelist prayed, the apostle, the chief apostle, the prophetess, the chief prophetess, everyone prayed. Everyone anointed you with oil. Everybody did all of that, but they never fasted. And now you're frustrated and they're frustrated. You're frustrated because the pastor has been praying for you. They've been joining on. They've been coming in agreement. They've been following certain protocols of the Bible, but nothing has happened. But they missed this protocol right here. So as a result of that, years went by and you're questioning God now. You're questioning the Bible. If preacher man, you're standing up on that pulpit and you're screaming every Sunday, if God be for me, who can be against me? No weapon formed. If that's a lie, because if that was true, how come you prayed, your fellow church members came by me, they put down all the anointing oil, they did all that screaming and speaking in tongues, and they did all of that, and I still broke. I still frustrated. I still mad. My marriage still failed. My children going crazy, smoking dope, prostituting, having children for all kind of different people. Nobody will marry them. What's going on? The revelation said this kind, the level of demonic activity that's residing in that part of your life, that is at work in your life, cannot, will not ever come out by prayer alone. And Jesus made it unequivocally clear in the scriptures, because his own disciples failed to heal this boy with this demonic witchcraft spell that was on him, that was causing him to do things that he would not do under normal circumstances. So Jesus giving this divine revelation that you must incorporate fasting in your prayer or along with your prayer when prayer alone is failing. So when you pray and you pray and you pray and you pray, and it's like you're praying against a wall. It's like your prayers is hitting the ceiling. Jesus now is giving this advice. He said this kind will only come out through prayer and fasting. Okay, now let's go a little bit deeper. Let's get more into this. Let's go to Luke chapter 4. And Luke chapter 4 is going to now show us that Jesus had already fasted over a 40-day period to equip himself for the demonic attacks that he would encounter on his tenure of his three-year ministry. Excuse me. So let's go to Luke chapter 4, and we're going to begin at verse 1. Luke chapter 4, beginning at verse 1 says, "And Jesus, being full of the Holy Ghost, returned from Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness." Now, I like what Mark 4, verse 1 says. It's given the same story. But Mark 4, verse 1 says that he was led in the wilderness to be tempted. Hey, go read it when you get a chance. Verse 2 of Luke chapter 4 says, "Being 40 days tempted of the devil, and in those days he did eat nothing, and when they were ended, he afterwards was hungry." Verse 3 of Luke 4. And the devil, and this is important now, because when you decide to take on a fast, then you better also be prepared for the onslaught of demonic activity in your life. A, primarily to discourage you from the fast, and the whole idea of discouraging you, because the enemy knows the spiritual power that comes along with someone who's disciplined or have a life of discipline and fasting. He's aware of that. So therefore, he's gonna deal with you, especially if you're novice in fasting. You might not even last 2 hours. You want to eat something or whatever the case may be, because there is a spiritual order, there's a spiritual implication, there's a spiritual power pack in fasting to deal with the unseen forces that they don't want you to have nothing to do with. So verse 3 says, "And the devil said unto him," which is Jesus, "If thou be the Son of God, command the stones that it be made bread." So the devil is now trying to tempt Jesus before and during the fast. And as you're going to see here, this is key, every time Jesus responded to the devil, he didn't row him, he didn't fuss him, he didn't say, "Get away." He kept saying, "It is written." What does that mean? He keep using the word. He keep taking the word of God and attacking this devil who is a spirit. Why? Because the spiritual law dictates us in Corinthians chapter 10, I think it's first or second, somewhere around there. It says, "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, they're not bottles and guns and sticks and bullies." He said, "Instead, they are mighty through God." God is a spirit, so our weapons are spiritual, to the pulling down of strongholds. So Jesus understood this law, and now he's literally fighting Satan. But he's not trying to whack him over the head. He's not trying to get an arrow and shoot him. He's not trying to get a javelin or a spear and throw it at him. How is he fighting the enemy? He's fighting the enemy in the spirit. How is that though possible, Kevin? It's possible because the devil is a spirit. And Jesus said, "It is written." And when he speak the word, and what is the word? According to Ephesians chapter 6, when it talks about the armor of God, the word is the sword of God. So when he spoke the word, in the realm of the spirit, that is the sword of the living God cutting at the enemy. So here, Jesus said, the enemy came to him, the devil came and says, listen, you hungry? Well, if you's the Son of God, if you all that, then turn these stones into bread. Jesus said unto him, it is written, this is the word now, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God. So as you see, when we go on, he's going to consistently deal with him on a spiritual level. Why am I putting emphasis on this? Because you need to know the word so that when the enemy come, when that boss rise up, when those children rise up, when your spouse act up, rather than popping F words at them, rather than cussing them out like you normally do, you mumble to yourself, you pray in your heart, or you pray out loud, Father, whatever this devil is of discord, of division, of rebellion in my house, it is written, and you begin to speak the word to that devil. Because the devil is using your family members, your boss, your cousins, whomever, to come at you so you could take the war to a physical level. And whenever you do that, then you would have violated the spiritual law, like I've been telling you over and over, in Ephesians 6 and verse 12. And what is that? For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. So what you rowing this man for? What you rowing this boss for? Why are you cussing out your neighbor behind her back? You now become a co-conspirator to your own demise. How is that? Because if you're violating the laws of God, the scripture now says that the enemy has control and influence over you. Kevin, I never heard that before. You making it up. Now prove that. No problem. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. And what does it say? Paul now giving a revelation. He said, wherein in time past, and he's talking to the Christians now, you once walk according to this world. And how did you do that? Lying, fornication, adultery, witchcraft, idol worship, hate, bitterness, deceit, you name it, all those evil things. He said, you once walk in accordance with that. Who, and how did this happen? He says, by the power of the prince of the air. So that evil territorial spirit over wherever you live was the one dominating you. But how did he do that? What gave him the right to do it? And it says, for this spirit is now working, listen to this now, in the children of disobedience. So, what does that all mean? Whenever I reject, whenever I discard, whenever I disobey the laws of God, I want you to hear this, according to Ephesians 2 and 2, then at that time, I surrender my will to the prince, which is a principality of the power of the air. Because now the scripture says, when I do that, he's now working in the children of disobedience. I am disobeying God's word. So now he has control. So his control is predicated on my defiance. That's why every demon that ever comes after you, his main goal is to get you to violate the law. Then he has the right to move in. So don't mind the arguments. Don't mind the husband acting up. Don't mind the boss freaking out. Don't mind that. All of that. That behind that are devils pulling the strings. Come on. Cuss up. Row up. Hate up. Say something bitter. Break the law. Because once you break the law, we got you. This is why the scripture now says to you, Paul, in Ephesians 6 and 12, he says, for we, the believers, do not wrestle against flesh and blood. The people and the physical things of this world are not our enemies. They are not our targets. They are not whom we ought to be fighting. We are fighting the invisible forces that are influencing them to pull us into the trap so that the enemy can have the legal right to run his course in our lives. So, going back to Luke now. Luke chapter 4, verse 5 says, and the devil, taking him, which is Jesus, up into a big mountain, showed unto him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. Verse 6 of Luke chapter 4 says, and the devil said unto him, which was Jesus, all this power will I give thee, Mr. Jesus, and the glory of them, for that is delivered unto me. And to whomever I will, I give it to. So the devil is saying, Jesus, listen, all of these kingdoms I own. but I'm willing to bargain with you. I'm willing to give them to you only if you bow to me. He's trying to get Jesus to violate the law. Watch verse 7. He says, if thou therefore will worship me, and all shall be thine. Verse 8. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan. Listen again. For it is written. Listen, those words aren't put there because the writers didn't have no other words to use. It is written is putting emphasis, or he's taking up his spiritual sword. He's not physically fighting the enemy. He's taking the word and he's speaking the word to this devil. Why? Because I've been telling you this over and over. When we utter, when we speak the word of God, the spiritual realm must submit to the laws of God. So Jesus said in verse 8 of Luke chapter 4, and Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Jesus understood the law in Exodus chapter 20 and verse 5, where God says, I am a jealous God, and if anyone worship any other God, I will visit the iniquity upon his present children and all the way down to his third and fourth generation. So Jesus understood the law, and now he's coming at this invisible being, this devil, with the law, which is the word of God. So he says, it is written. This is the, I'm whopping you, Mr. Devil, with the word of God. Watch verse 9. And he brought him to Jerusalem. See, this devil is relentless. And this is how he's going to be in your life when you decide to take on a fast. And he brought him, the devil brought Jesus to Jerusalem and set him on a pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the son of, he's always questioning his authority. And that's what he's doing to you. You sure you call? You sure you're an apostle? You sure you're a prophet? You sure these things ain't just coming out of your head? That's the devil trying to make you entertain and negotiate with him only to bamboozle you in the end. But you must stop letting him speak all the time. You speak to him. I do it all the time. I speak to him. I let him have the word. That's what you come for, because that's what you can get. Speak the word to the voices that's speaking to your spirit. Don't sit there and take it, because when you sit there and take it, you're entertaining it. Something is telling you, boy, I got this doctor report. I hope this man don't tell me nothing stupid. I hope he don't tell me I have no cancer. Why are you saying that? Who's telling you that? Speak to that spirit of infirmity that is trying to get you to agree with him. Spirit of infirmity, I reject you. No cancer will live in the temple of the Lord. No diabetes, no high blood pressure. If mommy and papi and whoever else had it, well, it ain't right here. It ain't gonna happen no further. This curse is broken today. No, every spiritual root that has caused those physical things to happen in my family will never happen to me, will never happen to my children. All the way to the 1,000th generation, they will be free of the generational curses that has descended. No further. I rebuke you. I reject you. I renounce you. You will never take place in the bloodline in my family from this day forward. Speak to it. Don't let it just speak to you. Shut him. Silence that evil voice. And you speak to that evil voice with the, tell him it is written. For Jesus Christ, because of his stripes, he's died for me. It is written. He sent his word to heal me. It is written. Because of his stripes, I am healed. Tell him. Don't sit there and mope. Oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. My heart feel like it's skipping a beat. Well, you better unskip a beat, because guess what? You need to come at this devil. This dude real. They real, and they're speaking to your spirit. So you need to speak to it with the word of God. So drop down to verse 9. And he brought him unto Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple and said unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down from thence. I love this particular one, because Satan becomes so desperate, he now trying to use scripture on Jesus. He say, okay, he keep using scripture on me. So let me, I'm a wolf, but let me put on some sheep clothing to try and fool him. So listen to verse 10. And listen to the scripture that he says. Because remember what he said in verse 9. He says, and he brought Jesus to Jerusalem and set him on the pinnacle of the temple. And he said unto Jesus, if you be the Son of God, Mr. Jesus, then cast yourself down, okay? For it is written, listen now, this Satan now, telling Jesus, it is written. Satan said, yeah, you will use spiritual weapon, but I can use some of this too. He says, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee. Now, Satan didn't lie. That is the word of God. That is found in Psalms chapter 91, verses 11 and 12. And it clearly states that, for he which is God has given his angels charge over us to keep us in all our ways, that if we as much as dash our foot against the stone, these same angels will gather us in their arms. So Satan now, see, because remember, even though he's quoting the word of God, if Jesus does it, he isn't agreeing with God, you know, he's agreeing with Satan, who's asking him to do it. So Jesus understood this. Satan thought he had the upper hand in this particular case. And I always say this to you all the time. How better to fool the sheep, which is the body of Christ, than to dress and act like the sheep. And if they're not spiritually inclined, they disable their sense of discernment and just accept you for face value. And this is why all the hell break through in your life with false prophets and so on. So verse 11 says, and in their hands, he's completing the scripture. Satan says, and in their hands, which is the angels, they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. Verse 12, and Jesus answered and said unto him, it is said, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. He's using scripture again. This is what I like. Verse 13, this is the last one. And when the devil had ended all the temptations, he departed for a season, which clearly indicates that he will return. So far, we've realized that fasting is enabled in a person's life, or the reason for it is to take him to a higher spiritual level, simply because he's dealing with higher level demonic forces. Okay? And this is why there are certain things in your life that you've been praying for over and over, but you've seen no changes in it, because you have yet to upgrade your spiritual warfare gear. And the only way that that can happen, according to the scriptures, is when you now decide to engage in a fast. Now, going back to Matthew chapter 17, from verse 14 to verse 21, remember, we realize that the disciples fail to heal the boy. And the question is asked, well, how come if they are students of Jesus? Well, even though they were students of Jesus, they never fasted while Jesus was present on earth in their time. As a result of that, even though they were students of Christ, and this only shows you how important fasting is, even though that their teacher was the Son of God, even though, they still didn't have the authority and power that only fasting can give to deal with that level of demonic activity. So, in order for us to see that, let's look at Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5, verses 33 to 35. Luke chapter 5, verses 33 to 35. And listen to what it says. Luke chapter 5, verse 33 to 35 says, and they said unto him, these are, I think there was the Pharisees saying to Jesus, why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers, and likewise the disciples of the Pharisees, but your disciples eat and drink all the time? Mr. Jesus, what's going on with y'all? Verse 34 of Luke 5. And he, which is Jesus, said unto them, can you make the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? So Jesus is this bridegroom. And Jesus says, as long as I'm here on earth, they don't have to fast. I have all the power, which they will use when I leave. But as long as I'm here, it's not necessary for them to fast. So that's basically what he's saying there. Verse 34 again. And he said unto them, can ye make the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? Verse 35. But the days will come, and this cover us now, but the days will come when the bridegroom, which is Jesus, shall be taken away, that will be after his crucifixion, from them, and they, not might, watch that word, and then shall they fast in those days. So what that means is that every human being who named the name of Jesus Christ, who is a believer of Jesus Christ, it is mandated for them to have fasting as a part of their spiritual diet. I don't care how you put that. Hear what Jesus say here? He says, when I leave, when I go, because remember, the whole you didn't have to fast while I was here, but when I leave and go, then the days will come when you will have to participate in that in order to build your spiritual strength to fight the higher authority of the powers of darkness that you will face in the future. So what does this mean? Let me use a perfect example. You're a Christian and you're married, and your husband decides to cheat with some woman who into demonic stuff, deep witchcraft. Remember now, the boy had a lunatic spirit. He was under witchcraft powers. And Jesus said that this thing here, which is witchcraft powers, the only way we can remove this is through prayer and fasting. So you don't know this. You don't know the spiritual atom bomb in the realm of the spirit. So you crying out every night. You getting up, doing your 12 o'clock midnight prayers, your 3 o'clock midnight prayers. Oh, I come against this, whoever my husband doing this with, and nothing. In fact, he's becoming worse. And you know why he's becoming worse? Because that level of demonic activity that is influencing him is just raising up even higher in their demonic activity to now bring further division in that marriage. This is why you need to have spiritual knowledge. Because if you decide to incorporate and go on a fast specifically for your legal union, and all hell can break loose on whoever trying to do what to that man to influence him to stay with them. All hell can break loose. So you have a lot of women and men who have lost their spouses as a result of witchcraft powers. And I'm talking about Christians now. All because of what they did not know. Thus, my famous scripture, Hosea 4 and 6, my people perish. Because what? They lack knowledge. Oh, I don't believe in that, man. Y'all just be talking about this thing too much, man. Y'all just bigging up the devil and praising, giving the devil too much credit, you know. I just have to shake my head. You are manless. You are womanless. Because you had a spouse before and it was taken from you by the powers of darkness. And you're still under the spirit of stupidity. And don't want to accept what the word of God says. You're still walking around with your proud, stupid self. Hello. Running on with garbage. Oh, I don't believe in that, man, on witchcraft. God powers greater. God is in control. Yeah, and he was in control when you was walking around with your fool self, ignoring the laws of God that was in place to eradicate that devil of division that came in your life and snatch God's blessing from you. Who's stupid now? So this is why you need to know spiritual law. This is why I come on here and pour my heart out with the revelations, so that you would now take a different method, a different strategy, stop going around that same mountain over and over. Child, y'all come go down with me and let's have prayer meeting, let's join hands. And the Bible say we're two or more of us touching anything. And yes, the Bible says that. The Bible does say that, and that law is true. But in this case, we've read it in Matthew 17, you are dealing with a higher level of demonic activity that all the joining of hands together in the world ain't gonna change nothing. You gotta add fasting to it. You gotta add, that's what the scriptures say. I ain't making this up. You read it. The disciples who were the students of Jesus Christ failed to heal this boy who had a lunatic witchcraft spirit on him. And only Jesus could do, because he was the only one who did the fast. And I can explain to you the mystery behind that. So I'm saying to you, they on the job working witchcraft. They sending all kind of evil spells at you, and it's working. Why it working? It working because you, Mr. Christian, refuse to adhere to the laws of God. You just going on what they preach from that pulpit. You do no study on your own. You do no research on your own. Well, one thing, pastor and pray for me. And pastor and put that oil on me. And let me tell you something. Let him come. I'm covered. You're covered and the fella got you in court for divorce. You're covered and he's telling you a part of this divorce They're either going to sell the house or you got to buy him out. So that means you lost your husband. You got to go further in debt. You got to start all over again. And you're blessed. And you're covered. But you know what? If that's what covering is, I don't want to be covered. No, I don't want to be covered. No, let me be. If that's what covering do for you, then take the cover off me. I want to cover on me. See, this is what ignorance does. This is what rejecting the word of God. When you believe more in a man and you reject the laws of God, then you know what the scripture says? I think it's in Jeremiah 17 and 5. Listen what it says. It says, cursed be the man that puts his trust in man and make flesh his strength. Or the King James version say, make flesh his arm, which means his strength. So, the scripture says, if you believe what pastors say, listen, I don't believe in witchcraft, but I don't believe in this foolish old bear man. Don't bring that around me. Okay? I don't believe in that. So what he's saying is that he don't believe in the Bible. Let's speak. Whatever the Bible, this is because this is what he's saying. He says, I don't, whatever the Bible says, but that everyone hear it. It's talking about Jezebel and the witchcraft. In Micah 5 and 12, it says that God will cut off the hand of witchcraft. Numbers chapter 22 to 23, it speaks extensively about Balak and Balaam trying to work witchcraft on the children of Israel down in the valley. We could go on and on. Jeroboam, who had an altar and worshiping Baal and all this. We could go down to Gideon, where his daddy was worshiping witch. So we may say he don't believe in that. And you believe him. Listen to the law. You have just invoked a curse on you. How? Jeremiah 17, and I believe it's verse 5. I stand to be corrected, but I know it's Jeremiah 17. He says, cursed be the man that puts his trust in man. I trust my pastor. He said, you don't believe in it? I don't believe in it. Even though God says it is the deal. So not only are you already cursed because they got it working on you, but because you put your faith in the apostle, because you, whoever they are that is rejecting the word, then you say, come on, curse. This one I got me, this ain't enough. Bring some more here to me. So this is why you need to, what does God say? But this, I don't care what the chief apostle say. Because if he is contrary to the word of God, then I got to reject him. In fact, I ain't coming here no more. Because the place curse. God says, anyone who I don't take away from my word, curse shall that poison be. That's what the scriptures say. That ain't what I say. Anyway, let's get back on this. So the disciples could not heal the boy because they were not fasting and they weren't required to fast because Jesus Christ, who was the bridegroom, he and the church, which is disciples and all that believe in him, was his bride. They didn't have to. But he, excuse me, clearly stated in Luke chapter 5 in verse 34 that when I leave, it is mandatory that every believer of Jesus Christ have some type of fasting in their life because every spirit that they deal with isn't on the same level. They are the higher hierarchy of demonic forces, and you need to be spiritually equipped and fortified through fasting in order to deal with that. Okay, now let's look at our next scripture as to how to fast. So let's look at Matthew chapter 6. Now, you know, there are many types of fast, and you know, there are many churches when January comes about, and you know, all of them say, oh, child, I'm going to do the Daniel fast, and I'm going to do Peter fast, and Tom Bo fast, and all these other people, right? Now, what gets me with them is that about a couple days into the fast, you hear more about, child, you see how much weight I'm losing? My God, boy, this, I don't, it comes more of a physical thing as opposed to a spiritual thing. And that's why a lot of them are disappointed that even after the fast that they don't see nothing change in their lives. Okay? Because their purposes, they never stuck or kept true to the purpose of any fast is to change spiritual order. Is to elevate you spiritually. That's the purpose of it. It's not for you to lose weight. That automatically comes along with it depending on the type and extent of fast that you go on. The fast is to give you revelation, give you understanding, give you spiritual insight. It primarily is to heighten your spiritual senses. In fact, automatically when you go on a genuine fast, your spirit of discernment is amplified. Okay? amplify one of the major signs of that, especially if you've been on a fast for more than 7 days. Okay, you know, by that time you should have been getting over your hunger pains, but your sense of smell becomes so acute, right? You pass in Kentucky, and you must be about 4 miles from Kentucky, and you could smell all that spicy and those 11 herbs and spices that man got on that chicken. All of this is just evidence of the spirit part of you being heightened, okay? You dream like nobody business. In fact, I posted something on that this morning. If you're having problems with recalling your dreams, if you're having problems understanding your dream, then that is also another indication that you need to be on a fast. Go on a fast, and I can show you all of that in this here tonight. Fasting breaks the bands of the things that had you oppressed as a believer. The job of a fast is to cut that in half, to separate, to break it, to loose the spiritual shackles that once held you back from propelling spiritually to the different levels of spirituality for you. The fast breaks that. Okay, so that's what it's all about. So in Matthew chapter 6, let's look at this. And they're going to show us how we should fast. And let's look at verse 16 to verse 18. Matthew chapter 6, from verse 16 to verse 18. Listen to what it says. Moreover, when you fast, be not as the hypocrite, hello, of a sad countenance. I fasted. You get what I see? See all this way they lose it? Don't be like the hypocrites of a sad countenance, their facial expression looking like they're fasting. It says, for they disfigure their faces that they may appear unto men to fast. They want everybody to know they're fasting. Verily, I love this. Verily, I say unto you, they have their reward. That's your reward right there. Everybody look at you. Boy, look at Minister Kevin. Look at Kev. I mean, Kev, look, he losing all that weight. My God, this boy really, he really on fire for God, eh? That's Jesus said, that's your reward right there. This ain't coming with no spiritual power. Your reward is the accolades that you've been looking for through the sadness of your confidence to garner attraction to you. He said, okay, now you better enjoy what they're saying because that is as far as it will go with you. Verse 17 of Matthew chapter 6 says, but thou, and he's telling us the right way to do it, but thou, when thou fast, anoint thine head and wash thy face. And thou appearest not unto men to fast. Don't look like you're fasting. Clean up yourself. Get a nice haircut. Brush your teeth. Throw some Listerine in your mouth and make yourself look good. He said, thou appeared unto men not to fast, but unto thy father. I love this piece. Which is in secret. Fast in secret. And thy father, which seeth you doing these things in secret. Watch it. I love this. Shall now reward you openly. Wow. I'm in my closet. I'm home. I'm fasting. I'm doing my 5-day fast, 2-day fast, 1-day fast, whatever fast. And I'm just pouring up to God and pouring up those scriptures and asking God through his word, Lord, this is what I want you to do. And this is what your word says. God, I'm believing you for my children. I want them to advance in life. I don't want them to be hindered by the things that once hindered me. I don't want them to be delayed like the things that once delayed me. And your word says, Father God, in Psalms 112, verses 1 to 2, it says that praise ye the Lord and blessed are those that fear him. And it says that the generation of the upright shall be blessed. Father God, this is what your word says. So I speak this over my children. And I pray, Lord, that this fast will break the bands of wickedness that is trying to conform them to that life or to those shackles that I was once set. And we'll go no further. So in your fast, you're going to take the word of God. And I tell you this all the time. Before you go on a fast, write down the scriptures that are relative to what you're going on the fast for. Because remember, the scriptures are the laws of God that the spiritual realm must submit to. So while you're praying, even if you got to open your eye and read the scriptures, that's all right. You just don't get the law there. And you read it. Father God, your word says in Psalms 115 verse 14, and this is about my children, that you will increase me more and more, me and my children. Your word declared, Father God, in Psalms, in Proverbs chapter 11 verse 21, you says that though hand join in hand, the wicked shall not be unpunished, but the seed of the righteous, I am the righteous, my children are my seed, shall be delivered. This, you giving God back his word. You are speaking the word of God in the realm of the spirit as it relates to your children, as it relates to you. So whatever you're going on a fast for, get the relative scriptures to accommodate the requests you are about to make to God. Why? Because God says in his word, he says, remind me of my word. I have placed my word above my name. My word cannot return unto me void. For my word is forever settled in heaven. My word, listen to what the word says now, Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5. It says that every word of God is pure and that he is a shield unto those that put their trust in him. Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 29. Listen to what it says. Is not my word like a fire? Is it not like a hammer that break the rocks in pieces? Father, I take your word that you have compared to a hammer, and I break the spiritual stones in my life, the spiritual stumbling blocks. That's how you got to pray, man. You want to fast. You want change. You want change the order that has been then guaranteeing a consistent negative outcome. You want to break that? Well, go on a fast and deal with the spiritual order against you. It's as simple as that, okay? Now, let's go and see now how God rewards those that go on a God genuine fast, okay? Those who decide to fast in secret, they ain't going to announce to everybody. They ain't going to the church and tell everybody what we're going to do. They ain't doing all of that. Now, let's see how God is rewarding. So let's go to Daniel. Let's go to Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1, and we're going to see how God deals with those, how he rewards them. And what I love about God, whatever you ask him for, according to the laws of God, he wants to do more. And the scripture tells us that, and Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, it says that he, which is God, will do exceedingly and abundantly and above all that we could ever ask or think, according to the power, and that power there means the word that works in us. So if you're asking God, God, I really believe in you for a new business or some ideas that you can, God's saying, yeah, I hear you, but I want to do more than that. I want to give you several businesses. God, I just want the down payment for this house. You know what? I think he's get upset with us when we say that. God, just give me the down payment. I really believe in my heart, according to Ephesians 3 and 20, I believe God is get upset with us when we do that. You know what he's saying? That's like, think of me being your father, and I'm a multi-billionaire. And you come to me, Daddy, listen, man, I try to get my own house. I just want to borrow 10% of the money from you. That's all I want. I can pay my own. I just want, you know what I can say to you? Boy, you think I work hard? You think I did all of this to give you a portion? Think about that for a second. So, and I'm plugging something in here. A lot of you out there, you can get exactly what you say. And when I say that, You pray for a portion, you can get a portion, then you got to deal with the other portion, paying that off for the next 30, 40 years. You serve a God that owns the earth. You serve a God who says that the silver and the gold belongs to him, the cattle and the thousand, the earth is his and the fullness there. He made the galaxy. So how do you tell this creator who owned the galaxy, who owned everything? God, I just want 50 cents to get something to eat. If it was me, I don't even listen to you. Because to me, I want to do more for you. I want to, listen to what he says. I want to do exceed, you know what exceedingly mean? Picture a line in front of you. Whatever's beyond that line is exceedingly. He says, I want to do exceedingly. What is abundantly? Picture you have a cup and it's already filled with water and you pour in more water in this. He says, I want to do abundantly. I want what you have that the world will look at you and say, this brother got to be serving God. There's no way in the world. That's how he want the sinner man and those of them who want to serve other gods. This is how he want them to look at you, to make them drop their witchcraft, drop their connivingness, drop their wickedness and say, I want to see him, God. He got over there. But that's hard to do when you're asking him for 10% on a $200,000 mortgage. Anyway, I let me leave that alone. So let's get to our brother Daniel. God is about to reward Daniel for a fast that he is about to go on. And I love the story. And we're going to pick this up from Daniel chapter 1 and verse 8. Listen to what it says. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat. Now this is interesting. Circle that word defile. And the word defile means to corrupt or change something from its original. I used this example before. You have a tall glass of white milk and you take some black liquid and you pour it into it. It's not white milk anymore. So that means you have corrupted, you have diluted, you have changed it from its original. That's what it means. So Daniel is saying here, I don't want nothing to do with the king's meat because it will defile me. Now, this is a teaching all in and of itself, but I can take you into deep revelation because remember, the king here was Nebuchadnezzar and they worship idols. And the meats that they eat was for demonic sacrifice and so on. And a lot of what they eat, they had a lot of demonic concoctions in it. This is why, and again, this is a different story. I'm just giving you a little surface here. Daniel said, I don't want that. I don't want none of that. You keep that. And so he's convincing the servant whom the king has assigned to him, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He says, listen, man, don't give us that meat. Let us have some vegetable, what they call pulse. And the servant said, man, I don't want to do that because if the king see you looking sickly, he can kill me. He said, no, I promise you. Give us 10 days, and after 10 days, if we look that way, then we'll start to eat your meat. Long story short, the Bible says that they went on a fast for 10 days just eating fruits. Okay? So let's take it now to verse 15 of Daniel chapter 1. It says, and at the end of the 10 days, this is the fast now, their countenance, which is their face, appeared fairer, watch this now, or look more beautiful or handsome, whatever, and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portions of the king's meat. Watch verse 16. And Melzar, this was the guy who was responsible for serving Daniel them, that the king had assigned to them. Thus Melzar took away the portions of their meat. Okay, I got you now. I see what you're saying, Mr. Daniel. So the meat I was bringing here, okay, I you don't got to eat that. It says, and he took away the portion of their meat and the wine that they should drink and gave them pulse, which is vegetables. Listen to verse 17, because now you're going to see, okay, what we just read over there in Matthew chapter 6, where it says, God says, listen, but a fast, you do it secretly, and I can reward you openly. Verse 17 of Daniel chapter 1 says, as for these four children, who's these four? Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And for these four children, listen now, God gave them, listen to this now, not, this is all as a result of the fast, knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. Listen to this now. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Everything he says here is true. Everything. Because I live that. I told you before in some of my other videos, in about 5-6 years ago, I took on the greatest fast ever. I used to go on 5-day fast, 3-day fast, 1-day fast. The highest I ever had was 21-day fast. And one time, I just couldn't take it anymore. I was having a lot of challenges, a lot of witchcraft attack, a lot of craziness happening in my life. And I made up my mind, by the grace of God, I went on a 40-day fast. No food, just water and juice for 40 days, consecutive days. To this day, I don't know how I do it, only the Spirit of the Lord. And I lived it. In fact, you're talking to me now as a result of this. The knowledge, the wisdom, the understanding that I have came as a result of my discipline in fasting. In fact, my wife and I just ended a fast last night. So I'm not speaking because I'm reading it from the pages. I lived it. I'm seeing up to this day the manifestation that comes along with it. So Daniel, those who did it secretly, God rewarded them openly. When Kevin was doing this 40-day fast, they say he got antsy because I dropped over 35 pounds. My hair done big, so I look like bobbly hair. And all my clothes was floating on me. When I come to church, my clothes look like a pamper. But I wasn't checking for them. I didn't care. I didn't care. When I got home, I would get my Bible and read and read and read. I said, Lord, take away this hunger. Take away this. Because some days the devil will come to me and I would be at work. I say, man, I don't care. I ain't doing this no more. I'm going to cook me some meat because I'm hungry. And by the time I'm midway home, driving home, God would snatch that desire from me. And I was determined. I was determined. I was determined. And during those times, I had some of the most vicious dreams ever. The Lord began to reveal to me the root causes of the things going on in my life and the people that were doing it. As it relates to my personal life, as it relates to ministry, as it relates to my job, everything was coming. The dreams was almost tormenting me. But all of this came as a fast. And what was to show me? The spiritual intelligence, the spiritual wisdom. God was giving me a look behind the scenes of the physical things that were happening to me. This is where I learned to deal with the spirits of people, places, and things, and not the people, places, and things itself. The fast gave me that understanding. So I'm speaking from experience here. Okay? So let's go now to Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10 now talks about another fast. Now, this was a partial fast in Daniel chapter 1 where they had some fruits and they just didn't eat no meat and all of that other stuff. And this fast specifically, and this is why I say, when I say to people, you're all talking about Daniel fast, do you know the purpose of a Daniel fast? Because it said what the purpose was. They got wisdom and all skill. Okay? And in Daniel's case, he got vision and understanding of dreams. So y'all don't keep sending me email over, not go on the fast, please. And you don't need my services no more. Go on the fast and say, God, excuse me, give me more than what Kevin have. I won't be like Kevin and interpreting you, but I won't be more, because you said in your word, Ephesians 3 and 20, that you want to exceed. I want you, give me, but you got to discipline yourself. You have to. So in Daniel chapter 10, the Bible says that Daniel went on a fast for 21 days. 21 days. And you know the story. The scripture says that God sent a messenger angel to Daniel, but he was interrupted or delayed. He was delayed by the spirit of delay, or the principality of delay, which was the prince of Persia. The prince of Persia, which is a spiritual principality. Remember, I told you a principality is a prince that rule over a region. So the Bible says that the prince of Persia, this is not a human being. Read the scripture. Now, there was a prince of Persia, a human being, who literally run the physical prince of Persia. But this was the spiritual prince that was responsible for all the evil. So the angel, or the messenger angel, which was sent from God, was delayed or hindered by the prince of Persia. So as you can see, the messenger angel, even though he came from God, we're talking about spiritual rank now, wasn't as powerful as the demonic prince. Remember, it's just a messenger angel. We're talking about a prince of Persia. So he had the ability to stop this messenger angel, Gabriel, in his tracks. The scripture goes on to say, this Daniel 10, verse 10, it says that reinforcement came to assist the messenger angel that came from God with Daniel's message. And that was one of the chief angels, which was Michael. I call him the minister of defense of the heavens. He came there, and the Bible says he withstood or subdued the prince of Persia. So all that I'm talking about now, these are all spiritual beings. And why am I telling you this? Because all of this spiritual activity is taking place in the heavens, unknowing to Mr. Daniel. Not knowing, though, this is going to encourage you, that this was all as a result of his fasting. So this is only giving you, the scriptures now giving you a behind the scene of what happens in the realm of the spirit when you fast. Yeah, you now begin to cause an uproar in the realm of the spirit. And the Bible says this man was on a fast for 21 days. And God is going to make sure that whatever he was asking for, he was going to get. Even if he have to send in his minister of defense, Michael the archangel. So the scripture says Michael the archangel came. Now remember, all this happened because of the fast. Michael the archangel came. He withstood the prince of Persia and allowed Gabriel the messenger angel to come to Daniel. He now began to share the heart of God to Daniel. And in verse 21 of Daniel chapter 10, listen what the messenger angel says to Daniel. All of this is spiritual insight. All of this is happening in the unseen world, which you don't see. Listen what the messenger angel said. The messenger angel said, Daniel, I have given you all that God has given me to give you. He said, but now I have to go back to fight. What do you mean by that? I just can't shoot back to the third heaven, the paradise of God. I have to go through the second heaven where the devil and his angels are. And they are going to resist me again. He said, now I must go back to fight. But watch what he says next. But he said, watch now, because of your fasting, he says, now when I leave, the prince of Persia is going to now call reinforcement, because all hell done break loose here. And he said, he's going to now summons the prince of Greece, the demonic principality that's ruling over the country of Greece is going to leave his post because his buddy over there in Persia getting kicked up from Michael the Archangel. Yeah, read the story. And you're going to see where there's this major spiritual chaotic activity going on above the head of Daniel. In fact, above the world. All because of Daniel fasting. So this is why now when you decide to make up in your mind, God, I'm going on a fast, man. I'm sick of these generational curses. I'm tired of being at the back of the line. I'm tired of not getting promotions and failing in my health. And I'm watching everybody in my family divorce and dying from cancer. I'm watching all these negative patterns and all of this resource here, and I ain't doing nothing. Father God, give me the ability to go on fast. Give me the fortitude to complete the tenure of which I set out. I need it. Okay? So, let me end this right here. Now we're going to come into the revelation of what happens in a fast. And it's going to, everything I've told you so far, I'm now going to give you. Now, I know you said, but Kevin, I thought that was the revelation there. No. I was just giving you the little sprinklings on the top. Now we can go into the revelation. So let's go to Isaiah. This is our last scripture for the night. Isaiah chapter 58. It's going to give us some profound revelation as it relates to fasting and the proper way to do it. And you are about to read and hear something right now that I am sure some of you have been on a fast already, have yet to do this part of the fast. And that's why you never got the full impact of what is in a fast for you. Okay, so let's go to Isaiah chapter 58. And in my Bible, it's headed, the heading is a genuine fast. This is so powerful. We're about to unearth some master revelation as it relates to fasting. And this is going to encourage you. Well, I hope it does. It's going to encourage you to make fasting a part of your spiritual discipline. If you have never fasted in your life and you've been a Christian for 2, 3, 4, 5, 10, 16, 20 years, man, listen, you ought to be flogged repeatedly, because how are you making this far? Okay? But I can assure you this, your life is filled with error. Your life is filled with bondage and failures and non-success, because you never added that atom bomb, I call it, in the spiritual realm, which is the method of fasting. So in Isaiah chapter 58, the children of Israel was having a problem. And they began to complain to the prophet Isaiah because they were saying that they were on a fast. And after they come up this fast, ain't nothing happening. All right, so they're complaining. So let's take it from verse 1. It says, cry aloud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. So this is God talking to his servant, the prophet Isaiah, and he says, show Israel where they have erred as it relates to fasting. Because they were out here running all the fool with me, and it is they are the problem and don't even know it. So verse 2 of Isaiah 58 says, yet, this is God still speaking, yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways as a nation that did righteousness. They behaving like they're righteous. And forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinance of justice. They take delight in approaching me as if they got some case running up in here. Verse 3. Wherefore have we fasted? This is Israel speaking now. Wherefore have we fasted, say they, and thou seest not? Meaning we fast and ain't nothing happened, God. Wherefore have we afflict our souls, and thou takest no knowledge? Say, God even recognize them. Behold, in the day of your fast, this is God speaking now, you fast for pleasure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know what they call a fast? They skip breakfast, but they hog down on lunch and dinner. To them, I just skip fast. I'm not going to eat. I'm not going to drink no coffee at my regular time. I'm not going to have no the pancakes and sausage and all them other things. I'm just going to eat dinner. God says, you fasted for pleasure and exact on your labor. Verse 4, behold, you fast for strife. Watch this now, and debate. Meaning that while you were fasting, you were still rowing, still carrying on. There was nothing sacrificial about what you were doing. He said, you're still fussing your neighbor and your co-worker. There's no humility in you. There's no secret in what you're doing in terms of a fast. Child, don't make me come off my fast for you. They got to know you fasting. You just doing throwing everything out there. He says, you smite with the fist of wickedness, still working your witch, even though you're on the fast. It says, ye shall not fast as ye do this day. This is not the kind of fast I call you to do. Where you make your voices to be heard on high. You're praying loud and carrying on. Ain't nothing really going on with you. Listen to verse 5. Is it such a fast that I have chosen? Question mark. A day for a man to afflict his soul? Question mark. Is it to bow down his head as a bulrush and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? Will thou call this a fast and the acceptable day? Is this what you call a fast? So God is clearly upset. He's perturbed by what they are fashioning to please themselves and calling this something acceptable for God. God says, no, no, I will not accept that. Watch what he says in verse 6. Because verse 6 is now going to give us the four initial things that happen spiritually when ones decide to go on a physical fast. I love this. Verse 6 of Isaiah 58 says, he's now telling them what to do. Is not this the fast that I have chosen? It's God speaking through Isaiah. Watch it now. Because this is what the fast is supposed to do. To loose the bands of wickedness. Now, everything I'm about to list here, they are all spiritual. I want you to get it in your head. The fast is going to break the bands of wickedness. Now, this is important. Let me tell you what this means. This wickedness part. People, I tell you all the time, they conjure up spirits through witchcraft. They call them from wherever. And once those spirits would have done what they had to do, they don't go back to hell. They don't go back to the ocean or to the skies or to the forest, wherever they conjure them from. According to Matthew 12:43-45, it says that whenever they're cast out, they go into dry places, unless you summons them to the abyss or to torment. But according to Matthew 12:43-45, it says that when an evil spirit is cast out of a person, it goes about roaming, looking for someone else to possess. And when the spirit does not find another home, then it now returns to try to re-enter its former human host. So after calling up the spirit, and let's use our island. And all of these people on different parts of the island work in witchcraft. And here is what's really happening from a spiritual perspective. They're calling evil spirits to the land, that even when the evil spirits have done doing what they do not leave the land. At that point, this is now what you call territorial spirits. There's a case of this in the Bible where Jesus was casting out a legion of devils out of a person. The spirit said to him, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Son of the Most High God, please do not cast us out, meaning don't take us from this territory. Please, let us at least stay here. And let us go into the pigs, onto the swines. And the scripture says Jesus agreed with them for whatever reason. That's what he did. And they went into the swines, and the swines ran down the hill and drowned themselves in the water. But the spirit stayed in the territory. So if someone's working witchcraft in a home, and that person leaves the home and sell the home and die and move on, whomever take that home on, whoever purchased that home, because they're now territorial spirits there, that's going to harass the new inhabitants or the new owners of the home. So this is why they will hear footsteps at night when nobody else is up. This is why there were things breaking out on the back end and so much strange stuff happening, and kids waking up with piercing screams at 3, 4 o'clock in the morning and crying as if they're actually seeing something. This is why, like, everything that could go wrong is good. Why? Because the place is infested with demonic activity. So again, this is what is called territorial spirits. Now, I said all of that to go back to the first order of a fast. It says this fast now is to deal with those things, to break the bands of wickedness. Now, let's be real. There are no physical bands around you, but there are spiritual bands. Is he saying you're wicked? No. The wickedness that has been brought to that land, brought to that place through demonic summoning of witchcraft and obeah to demonic altars, those spirits take ownership of wherever it is that they were called. Think about a place, a particular street you know right now. Think about a particular place. And it is a place known for car accidents with death. Every time they have an accident on that particular street, someone dies. Well, I could tell you that would something happen on that street where spirits were summoned, and as a result of it, everyone that dies on that street is a sacrifice to that spirit. Hello. So unless some person with insight decides to go to the place where the accidents always happen and anoint that place under the power of the Holy Spirit and after fasting and break the curse, until Christ come, accidents will take place and will always be an accident with death every time. I tell you that. Because they're territorial spirits dominating that place. So, but a fast though, according to Isaiah 58 verse 6, it says, is not this the fast that I have called? To break the bands of wickedness. He said the wicked spirits, the wicked evil, the wicked sacrifice, the drinking of blood, the slicing of their skins and putting concoctions in themselves and drinking certain concoctions. He says these are the wicked devils that they have summoned, and only a fast can break this. He said to break the bands of wickedness, listen out, to undo heavy burden. What burden, Kevin? I see no burden on me. Spiritual burdens. You toting stuff that don't even belong to you. What are these spiritual burdens? Curses. Your pa drink liquor all his life now. You got this major temptation for liquor. Burden. Your pa, ma fornicate, sweetheart on each other. Now you got a good man or good woman, God bless you with, but you feel the strong impulse to have additional affairs. Burdens. Every time you go forward, it's like something that's blocked your hustle. Burdens. Every time there's a promotion coming up and you have everything, the boss is nearby, say, you got this one. Somebody else with less qualifications come in front of you, get burden. He says the fast will break that burden. What he says is, that's only two. It's not just the fast that I have chosen to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo. To undo means that you are unloosing something that was tied. So the burden was tied to you, but the fast will untie it. I love this. This can encourage you to go on a fast if you had an issue before. The fast is going to undo what mama them did. The fast is going to undo what your ancestors did. The fast is going to undo the covenants that they established in the past. Only a fast can do that. It says it will undo or loose the bands of wickedness, undo heavy burdens, not just burdens, but heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free. But Kevin, what you mean oppressed go free? I was never locked up. I never spent a day in prison. I know. But my dear, the worst prison you've been in is the spiritual prison, meaning you was locked up and you don't even know. And a spiritual prison simply means that they have caged you spiritually, which automatically sets limitations in your life. The best way I could give it to you as an example, picture a bird in a cage. This bird have the ability to fly wherever he want to fly. But the bird is subject to the size of the cage. Thus meaning his freedom is only as far as the cage will allow him to go. So that's how your spirit is in the realm of the spirit prior to the fast. You're a Christian. I used this the other day. You're anointed, but can't do nothing.
You're full of the Holy Ghost, like you say, but cannot perform no miracle. Because you're laden with curses. You're laden with spiritual bondages and don't know. Because they have taught you from the pulpit, once you got Jesus, everything is all right. Child, just call on Jesus and you're going to worry about it. Child, you're covered under the blood. Yeah, you're covered under the blood and you're broke. You're covered under the blood and you're sick. You're covered under the blood and by next year this time you're divorced. You're covered under the blood and about 5 years from now you will be in the obituary column prematurely. Because no one never said to you, even though you are a Christian, there are laws that you need to put in place to fight the assigned demonic forces that are now going to be attracted to you because you decide to take on Jesus. Nobody tells you that. So all your life, you've been just hearing about the blessings. I have to put this in all my teachings because I will make this clear. And no one never gave you a balanced gospel. So every night, the devil had a head start, a jump on you. Because why are you focusing, well, pastor, and tell me, God can bless me with a 4x4 Land Rover. Don't mind me walking now, you know. I done name it and claim it, sweetie. I done name that and claim that. But I hope you name and claim your healing. I hope you name and claim poverty was about to roll up on you. I hope you name and claim that spirit of murder that's been running throughout your family. I hope you've been naming and claiming that spirit of premature deaths in your family. You done had several family members that died before the age of 50. And look how things going. If you look, you can be next. Did they tell you how to deal with that? Did they tell you to go on a fast? And first, before you go on a fast, to record all of the negative patterns in your family. And now you go grab the word of God and go on a fast and begin to break the negative trends. Did they tell you that? No, they didn't tell you that. You know why they didn't tell you that? Because all they want to preach is like Jesus is this beautiful Jesus. And once you got him, oh, nothing is going to go wrong because he is in control. And you must, like you just want to high. Oh, I'm just high. You're just like a drunkard. Oh, whatever happens, happens. No. No, whatever happens is happening because a law that was activated or deactivated. It ain't happening because it could happen. You ain't broke because you won't be broke. You ain't sick because you won't be sick. These are curses. Somebody is neglecting the law. Somebody is perishing because of a lack of knowledge. It's as simple as that. So he says to break the bands of wickedness, to undo heavy burdens, to set the oppressed free. You're oppressed on your job. You're oppressing your marriage. You're oppressing your wages. But he says the source of all of this is spiritual. And what the fast does is it break the oppression, the spirit of oppression. And once the spirit of oppression is broken from the realm of the spirit, then it is mandatory that you excel in the natural. Because like I've been teaching you over and over, nothing happens in this physical realm unless it was done, conceived, manufactured, or made in that realm. All the spiritual realm is looking to us too is to agree with what has already happened over there. So the fasting, this is the revelation now, the revelation of fasting is that when you decide to take on a fast, it means that there is a spiritual order against you. There's a spiritual injunction. There's a spiritual ordinance that's speaking against your destiny, that's speaking against your generation, that's speaking against a certain thing in your life that you want to break it from its origin, and the origin will always be spiritual. So this scripture here in Isaiah 58, in verse 6, is giving us the four primary spiritual evil that is encompassing a human being that he or she is not aware of because they cannot see it. But he says a fast will automatically break it and now cause you to achieve, cause you to succeed, cause you to excel, cause that mark that was on you, that in the realm of the spirit, other spirits recognize you, say, he or she was marked not to get married. He or she was marked not to have children. He or she was marked was never to have success in life. Remember, let's go back to the story in, I think, Genesis 4, Genesis 5. After Cain killed his brother Abel, it says the Lord put a mark on him. So no matter where he went, they know, oh, that's a loser there. We're talking about a spiritual mark now. That in the realm of the spirit, or he from the Ewing family. Okay, familiar spirit, what file we have on him? Okay, the Ewing family, we got cancer, we got servant idols, We got lying, fornication, children out of wedlock. We got multiple marriages. We got this. Okay, this is the order against them. Okay, the altar that they sacrifice at, those familiar spirits are to enforce the covenant. So make sure they never marry. And if they do, make sure they marry 100 times. Make sure they have children while they are married with different people. Make sure that all the men are failure. Make sure the men are having some type of cancer. Make sure the women have breast cancer. This is the order. This is the injunction against you spiritually. Generational curses. And those invisible forces in the form of the band of wickedness, in the form of heavy burden, in the form of oppression, in the form of heavy yokes, they are the ones to enforce the edict against you, the laws that speaking, the injunction against you. But a fast will break it. That will be making sense to you. Now, let's look at some more stuff here, what the fast is going to do, because people do this all the time, and this is where the revelation is too, part of it. When you go on a fast, and in this case here, they are abstaining from food. They're abstaining from food. But while they're abstaining from food or water or whatever they're doing, there's something that they're now supplementing. All the eating they used to do and the whatever, they're now going to do a supplementing. Now watch what the scripture says. In verse 6 it says, "Is not this is the fast that I have chosen, to loose the band of wickedness, to undo heavy burden, and to let the oppressed go free, and to break every yoke?" This is what the fast is going to do. Verse 7 says, "Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry?" Now this is revelation. He says, now while you are fasting, listen to this carefully, the pleasures you would have had in eating food, the three-course meals or the two-course meals, he says, now you find someone to give those meals to. No one ever tell you that in fasting, eh? But look at the scripture, because we're looking at the protocol now. Nobody never told you that. Because before, you just say, I'm going to turn down my plate and I'm going to make this sacrifice to my God. But it's more than that sacrifice. It's more than just turning down your plate. It's now taking the plate that once used to be filled with food, and now you go find someone. If you have to take a plate of food to a bum, to a, someone less fortunate, the scriptures say, not Kevin, because we want to do this the right way. The scripture says in verse 7 of Isaiah 58, "Is it not to deal or to give thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor," listen to this now, "that are cast out to thy house?" I know you're all into that. You heard he say, right? He said, the poor people out there who are less fortunate, who got no place to stay, he said, bring them to your house. Now, you probably didn't turn off this video now, because I know you say you ain't bringing nobody to your castle. But I just tell you what the law says, okay? If you want to do that on you, if you ain't want to do that on you, he says, while you are fasting, while you are doing this secretly, while you are making your petitions to God, while you are abstaining from food, from water, or whatever, whatever you abstain from, whatever once used to be pleasures for you, he says, while you are on this fast, you must ensure that somebody else are now getting what you used to get. Those meals that you used to have, do you know someone who ain't got no food or whatever, they're in a less position? Then you go and all of this while you're not eating. And I did this before. But I didn't bring no one to my house. And find nobody to bring down. Probably because I wasn't looking for nobody. But anyway, you must now follow the law. Watch what it says next. It says, "Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, give this people food while you on a fast, and that thou bring the poor to thy house who has been cast out?" It says, "When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him." Don't be pointing. Don't say, look at her, look how she come into church in that old tied up skirt, old Jezebel spirit. No, according to this, he says, while you on a fast, then you go take them. Take them down to the clothing store and buy stuff for them. Yeah, this is what it says. He says, while you are on the fast, you must now become a servant. This is what it says. Did they ever preach this to you in church? No, you never heard this. What you heard was you go on a fast and you discipline yourself and you don't eat and you just pray. But that isn't all. You must now give. And not only giving in one area, clothing, shelter, food. Read it. Isaiah 58 verse 7. Because the next scripture is going to show what is now going to be added to you supernaturally as a result of following this protocol added to your fast. Verse 7 says, is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thy... Don't duck and hide when you see them. You're violating the protocol of the fast. In fact, while you're on the fast, you should be looking for people to help. You should be looking for people to assist. You should be taking the resources that you once would have been dabbling in while not on a fast and now give it to somebody else. I said losing some people here now. I figured out what happened because they won't hear this. Listen to verse 8. Listen to verse 8. He says, now that you are on the fast and you have now given all of these things, you helping them with clothing, you helping them with a bill here and there, you're giving them food or helping pay their little rent. See, it don't necessarily mean that you got to bring them in their house. If you could help them, they may be short on their rent. Okay, Kevin, I'm glad you said that piece. So let me help them with their rent so they can have a roof over there. Yes, you still do the same thing. You assist in here. Now watch what happens as a result of this. Verse 8. Then, I love that word. That's like the word if. Meaning that only when you do this in verse 7, then you can get verse 8. Verse 8 says, then shall thy light break forth as the morning. He's talking about your wisdom now. Meaning that what used to be dark before, those dreams, you just had a detailed dream last night and you can't remember nothing when you get up. You some things you become so forgetful that you just read something and you couldn't calculate like how you used to in your mind. He says, now when you do this part of the fast, he says, then shall thy light break forth as the morning. So that means for something to break forth, and let's look at this in our mind now, that means it was tied down before, it was restricted. So he says, the devils on that higher level, according to Matthew 17 and 21, this kind of will only come through prayer and fasting, because of their hierarchy, because of their class, because of the breed of devils that was against you, they had you unlock your wisdom, your knowledge, your understanding, because you never incorporated a fast. But he says, now once you add this fast, they can't hold you no more. Because now you're coming on a level above them. But it could only happen in a fast. I hope you are getting this tonight. Watch this now. He says, then shall thy light break forth as the morning. Oh, Jesus, I love this piece. And thy health, listen to this now, shall spring forth speedily. What is he saying? He's saying the spirit of infirmity, because who is he speaking to in these scriptures? Is he speaking to unbelievers? No. Is he speaking to witchcraft workers? No. Are he speaking to liars? No. He is speaking to the believers of God, the believers of Christ, the believers of the creator of the universe, God Almighty. He is talking to Christians here. He says, Christians, if you want to grow in your faith, Christians, if you want to advance spiritually, Christians, if you want to do signs and wonders, Christian, if you want to go above or beyond with your, where your ma been, where your pa been, where your uncle was an apostle, your uncle was a chief prophet, none of them, not one of them performed a miracle before they left. No wonders and works had been worked through them, none of them. But you want to change that? Add this fast, follow this protocol. And watch what's, I am a living proof of it. Watch what's going to happen. So he says, if you ailing with cancer, if you ailing with witchcraft sickness on you right now, and you cannot go forward, they prayed for you, the pastor anoint you with Western oil, Crisco, lard, and all this stuff, and nothing happening for you. He says, time to go on a fast. And watch what he said. He said, your health, let me read that again. He says, your health shall spring. When I hear that, you know what I envision in my mind? You ever saw those guys in the Olympics when they're doing the diving? How they jump once and twice before they flip? And that board does spring them forth. So he says, your health shall spring forth speedily. That means that the shackles that once held, would once held you down in the realm of the spirit that was stopping your healing, the Bible says the fast is going to break that. And that sore from diabetes we couldn't heal is going to heal speedily. That bronchitis you had is going to heal speedily. That cancer that you had, speedily. because you follow the protocols, not just abstain from food, but you decide to give others the food you would have once eaten, clothe others, pay somebody else rent, or bring them in your place to live for a short period of time, whatever the case. You now begin to become a servant while you are making a sacrifice unto God by abstaining from food. I love this so much. So verse 8 said that your health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. Verse 9, then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Who is he talking to? He talking to the Christian. So that means before the fast, he wasn't hearing you on that level, of course. God, please, Lord, they work witchcraft on my boy. Jesus is used to be a sensible boy. Oh, he eating on the garbage, Lord. He walking the road naked. Jesus, oh, Lord, fix it. Jesus, fix it, Lord. God say, I'm hearing you. Not on this one. This level here, this kind, will only come through prayer and fasting. I will help you, but I can't break my own law. Now, what you need to do is go sit under some preacher who got this understanding, who was excited about doing my law. Come out of that Mickey Mouse church and go and sit where they're teaching my law. Where you will now discipline yourself on a fast, and while you're fasting, you are assisting, you are helping others, you are giving to others. Then shall your health break forth speedily. Then shall this happen. But as long as you sit down and say, God in control, and what God got for me, those rhythms and rhymes are not in my Bible. Those cliches are not my laws. My law says that if you give to the poor while you are fasting, if you assist others with clothing and make sure they're not walking around naked or whatever, if you give help someone with their shelter and their rent or their mortgage, say when you do these things while you are fasting, verse 8 says, then shall thy light, then shall your wisdom break forth, your understanding, your insight as the morning. Your health shall come forth speedily, and your righteousness shall go before you. But it didn't end there. Verse 9 says, then shall you call upon the Lord, and he shall answer. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here I am, now I will hear you. Because you have finally taken the fast and come up to a level where now we can communicate on a greater spirituality. And all of those devils of oppression, devils of all these, say they can't touch you now because you've decided to operate in my law, and as a result of this law, you have caused yourself to be elevated above the principalities and all these other evils that once oppressed you. You need to incorporate fasting in your spiritual diet, believers of Jesus Christ, all of you, every last one of you. If not, you are going to be limited. If not, you're going to be restricted. If not, then you will be every minute emailing me and telling me demons biting you up in the dream, snake on your bed in this dream, that. And I can say to you, you got to go on a fast. You got to do this. And you say, oh, Brother Kevin, you know, I got high blood. Brother Kevin, I got this. Go to the Holy Spirit and let him advise you. But don't write me on these things. Don't ask me if you refuse to be disciplined and breaking these things, because I am not your stick that you lean on. I give you the word, and if you reject the word, do not call me. Listen to me carefully. Don't write me, don't call me, because you are a waste of my time. If you reject the laws that I am telling you tonight, please, I will delete you and block you, because I don't have time to waste. We dealing with serious business here. We dealing with people's lives. We dealing with people's destiny. And if you like what the devil is doing to you, then you need not be on my page, because I'm about setting people free through the laws of God. Now, I know that's harsh, but I got to be real with you. I ain't going to waste your time, so I would appreciate if you don't waste mine. If I say to you in an email, this is what your dream says, because I've had this a couple times, and I won't get this out there. And I say to you, go and write down the scriptures and go on a real fast. And I take you through the same thing right here. And then 2-3 months or 2-3 weeks later, Brother Kev, remember that dream I tell you about? I see in these things happen in my life. And you all notice, the first thing I'm going to say to you, because I'm going to look at the history of that email, did you follow what I said to you on above of this email? And if you say to me, boy, the devil had me, delete. You're talking to me. I will hear you no more. Because clearly you like it. So do not waste my time. Because I put a lot into what I'm doing now for you to waste my time. And that's not going to happen. So the scripture, I'm giving you the protocol here. The protocol is, this is how you break those evil patterns of evil in your life that once had you oppressed. You got to break it spiritually. And that is what the fast does. It breaks it spiritually. I'm going to read this last piece and I'm finished with you. In verse 9 says, and thou shalt call, and this is all after the protocol, and the Lord shall answer, meaning he wasn't answering you before because you didn't do the fast. Thou shalt cry, and he shall say, here I am. So you know what's happening before? He was crying, oh, Jesus, will you come, Lord Jesus? And God says, yeah, as soon as you go on the fast. Lord, turn it around for me. Lord, I can't take this being from the... Yes, when you go on the fast, then I can actually at least look at you. But until then, do not call me. And that's what I tell them. You don't call me either if you don't want to do the fast. Verse 9 says, then shall thou call, and the Lord shall answer. Thou shall cry, and he shall say, here I am. If thou take away from the midst of thee the yoke, the putting forth of the finger and speaking vanity. So what he's saying now, he says now, there's another set of blessings that's going to come while you're on the fast. He said, now, while you're on the fast, if you stop pointing fingers and accusing other people and speaking evil and gossiping, if you do this, I shall hear you. If you do this, I'll respond to you when you cry. So what he's saying in so much word, cut all that negative. Once you go on a fast, this is a time of consecration. This is a time. This is why you should prepare for a fast. Shut down everything. In fact, you should be preparing for a fast a week before the fast. That's what you should be doing. You don't just jump on one. You should say, okay, now, no more TV for me. I go on this 3-day fast, 2-day fast, whatever. I ain't want to hear no more TV. I ain't on the radio. I ain't into none of that. Let me get my scriptures. In fact, let me go watch Brother Kevin videos while I'm on this fast. Let me get the word in me. Or let me go watch whomever else I like to hear preaching. Because all I want in this fast is the word of God penetrate my spirit. Because when I done finish listening to this word or reading the Bible or whatever, now I'm going to pray. And I'm going to put these things before God, all right? And always keep a pen and a piece of paper to your bed because the dreams are going to come like that. God is going to be started revealing. The Bible says God speak to you in dreams, in visions, when men fall asleep at night. So you need to have a pen and paper. I say this to you all the time when I write you my emails. When you go on a fast, have pen and paper to your bed. If you're not a person who likes to write, you got a phone with the voice recorder. And as soon as you wake up, you begin to speak the dream into that voice recorder. Because more than likely, when you lay back down, if you do remember, it'll probably be in pieces or you won't remember it at all. So you get the little voice recorder, your little smartphone, you press the voice and you begin to repeat the dream. Because at that point, you're going to remember it in detail. So that by the time you wake up and take a bath and catch yourself, now you go play it. And God is going to give you revelation. If not, you could forward it to me, and I'll interpret it for you, all right? So, back to this now. He says, all of this would happen if you stop gossiping. Verse 10 says, and if, watch that word. When you see the word if and then, that means it's dependent, something you got to do. Verse 10 of Isaiah 58 says, and if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted. What he's saying here now, if you now become committed while you're on this fast for meeting the needs of others, you're giving them food and you're assisting the afflicted. If thou draw thy soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity and thy darkness as the noonday. Meaning that things that was once oblivious and dark in your life, it had seemed that there was no hope for it. But he said, while you are fasting, and I want you to record this and watch it in your life. And not to record it, but observe it. While you are fasting, find someone life to invest in. And God says, that child you wanted to send to college, and this child is about to graduate this year, and you know you ain't got no money. You want this child to go to college. You want to break this cycle where nobody in your family ever went to college, but you want your child to go. But there's no finances. And the government only can give to their cronies, and no one can help you. The scripture says here how to cause what seemed to be dark for light to come on it, for God to pull that situation, put you on top. He says, go on this fast while you're fasting, help other people. Now, when you get back to pray, Father God, I am following your law as best as I could. If there are things that I'm missing, then bring it to my memory. Let me go read the scripture again to make sure I cover. I want TJ or PJ. I want this boy to have a good life. I want my daughter to go surpass where I ended up. I got pregnant when I was young, or I was having children at age 14, Lord. I don't want them to be this way. I want them to go to school. I want them to get an education. I want them to have a good marriage and a good family. But I read in your word that while I'm on this fast, I must give to others. Lord, lead me to the people you want me to give to. Whatever it is you tell me to do, I want to make that sacrifice because I want my child to excel. This is how you got to do it. This is how you got to do it. This is how you got to do it. Okay? Father, I want to break the spirit of poverty in my life. My people talk about a broken home, and they take a broken home, meaning that the mommy and the daddy ain't there. But the truth is, my ma broke, my pa broke. That's a broken home right there. Father God, I won't be broke no more. So therefore, I want to give the little that I have while I'm on this fast to so-and-so around the corner who clearly is in need. Let me do this and let me do that because I need the spirit of poverty to be broken so it don't pass on my children. This is the law to do that. I hope I'm making sense tonight. I hope I am making sense to you tonight. This is the key to break you free. You write me all the time, Kevin, how do I break the covenants? How do I break the generational crisis? This is here. I've spent almost 2 hours now educating you on how to do it. It's up to you now. So watch us finish this now. In verse 10 it says, and if thou draw out thy soul to the hungry and satisfy the afflicted soul, then shall thy light rise in obscurity and thy darkness as the noonday. Verse 11. Watch this now. I love this. All of this because of a fast. Verse 11 says of Isaiah 58, and the Lord shall guide thee continually. You hear this? All because of the fast. Are you hearing this? Let me tell you why I just get mad. I just get angry. I call it righteous indignation. Because they're telling you in the church, sow a seed. That's what they tell you. They're telling you in the church, nothing leave God's hand until something leave your hand. Where scripture is? Where it is? They're telling you in the church, you have to make a sacrifice unto God. Take your first paycheck and give it to pastor, give it to the church. And what you do in the month of January, God will do for the next 11 months for your life. How much times you don't do that? Not now. How much times? But we read here that the sacrifices go on a fast and you must not give to a church. Did you see it in there? Did you read in there, give to the church? You read that, right? Your tithe and stuff, that's what you give to the church. But this is a whole new protocol for a different end result. So don't listen to them. Listen to this. And the scriptures say, if you go on the fast and give to the less fortunate in all the areas that he tells you to give in, then certain things are going to change. It cannot change before that. So who are you going to listen to? You going to listen to him or you going to listen to God? Well, you know, we have a tradition in this church that every January, we take the first either month's salary or the first week's salary. And aside from your tithe, now don't get it mixed up with your tithe, and we're going to give that to the pastor. You know, once pastor is debt-free, then, you know, the blessings fall on everybody else. Yeah, what that is? What that is? That ain't what I read in here, my brother. That isn't what I'm reading to break the spiritual order in my life that I have seen descended from generation to generation. And now look, you're coming on me. I read here that I must go on a fast, number one. And aside from that, that I must follow a certain protocol on that fast in giving to those who are less fortunate. And in nothing I read in there where I must give to a pastor or a church. I read that there is a time to give to a pastor. There is a time to give, but not in this case, to get the end result that I want that is telling me will happen once I follow this protocol. So if what you're telling me, Mr. Pastor, is I must go contrary to me, you need to get from around me. Because you're full of the devil. I haven't that. I'm going along with this because I'm looking at the word if and I'm looking at the word then. And it says, if I do this, then this will happen. If I give to the poor, feed them while I'm on the fast, this will happen. If I purchase them clothes for the needy, this will happen. If I give them a place to stay or help them with their rent or their mortgage, this will happen. But you're telling me that I must bring you my money. You're telling me if I sow $100 or $1,000, then God is going to break the yoke. You're telling me that God is going to break the bands of wickedness if I sow the seed. But I am not reading that. I am reading that if I fast and I do X, Y, Z, I'm going to get wisdom, knowledge, understanding. I'm going to get where it was once darkness and my back was against the wall financially and all these things, and I couldn't help my children go to college. That if I give while I'm on the fast, God is going to fix that. If I give while I'm on the fast, God is going to heal my body of sickness. If I give while I'm on the fast, he says, then shall thy light break forth as the morning, which is wisdom. If I give during the fast, he says, then shall I hear you. When you cry now, I can hear you. If I give during the fast, in verse 11, he says, I will guide you continually. All these benefits if I follow this protocol. But you're telling me, Mr. Pastor, Mr. Apostle, prophet, super prophet, super duper prophet, all your other people, that if I give you, there's a shortcut to the blessing. The devil is a liar. Get away from me. I can follow this. It seems harder, but I can, God say do this, so this is what I'm going to do. Let me finish this. For Isaiah 58 verse 11 says, and the Lord, as a result of you giving to other people, he says, and the Lord shall guide thee, giving to other people while you're on the fast, continually, watch this now, and satisfy thy soul in drought. Your soul is your mind, your will, your intellect. It's the administrator of your entire being. So that means, drought means that you were once confused, depressed. You were once fatigued and frustrated. He says, as a result of following my law, he says, not only will I guide you continually, in verse 11 of chapter 58 of Isaiah, he says, and I will satisfy thy soul in drought, and make fat thy bones, and thou shalt be like a watered garden. You know how a watered garden is? It's greenery all over. You shall be like a watered garden, and like a spring of water whose waters fail not. That means the blessings are going to be continually. Did you sow any money yet? No. He asked you to sow a seed of money? No. Did he tell you to give $1,000 seed? No. Did he say give a miracle oil? No. Did he ask for a miracle cloth? No. That ain't what I read here. Verse 12, and they that shall be of thee shall build the old waste places. That sounds like restoration to me. Okay? Thou shall rise up the foundations of, I love this piece, many generations. I love that. Because the fast, this protocol in Isaiah 58 is saying that what you're doing, not only will you be blessed, not only will you be healed, not only will you advance, not only will you have wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, but you are changing the foundation that was once polluted by your ancestors. And now the foundation is being set up for God, and the generations ahead will benefit as a result of it. Ask Solomon. Solomon disobeyed God. Solomon had 1,000 wives. Solomon served idols. God finally approached him. Solomon, I'm about to take this kingdom from you. You are a disgrace to me. Hold on now. I can't do it. I can't. I just remember something. Because of your father David, because of his sacrifice, because of his fasting, because of your father, I will not punish you in your lifetime. You will still enjoy life. But your children will pay for this. So you see, this was going to happen to you. Your children, when you're already dying off the scene, and trouble come to the door of your grandchildren, great-grandchildren, great-great-great-grandchildren, God is going to see the record. Kevin Ewing, in 2016, 2014, made a sacrifice to me through prayer and fasting. He gave to the poor. He followed my law. So therefore, Kevin Jr. to the third, fourth generation, there's a court case coming up for him. But he had to get free because of what his pa did in the past. His great-great-granddaddy. It was me. So what you're doing now isn't just to affect your life. You are setting a new foundation to break the bad stuff in your family to now set a new record. You are changing the foundation that was polluted by your ancestors through fasting to set a whole new. What we're doing right now is pouring a new floor. We are setting up, we are digging new trenches. We are excavating that old demonic order. And now we're putting down the principles of God and setting a foundation for our future generation to build on. So when we are dead and gone and go on to glory, we can leave this earth with no regret at all, because spiritually we have put everything in place so that the future generation, and even us now, shall live a better quality of life. I don't want to go through the rest of the scripture because it's too long, it will be too long, but I admonish you to continue reading Isaiah 58. Is a powerful scripture on fasting. And I just want to pray with you before I go. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your wisdom. I thank you for your knowledge. I thank you for your understanding. I believe with all my might, God, that your word that I've imparted into your people tonight has broken and plowed the ground of hardship, all in an effort to begin a new order in the lives of the people hearing and watching me tonight. Father, I thank you because your word has not gone forth in vain. Excuse me. I believe with all my might, Lord, that your word has crushed the head of every snake in their life, crushed the head of every form of oppression, break the bands of wickedness, release them from the spiritual cages that they were once in. Why do I believe this? Because your word dictates, your law states that through knowledge shall the just be delivered. The just, a specific set of people. The just who have listened to me tonight. The just who have made up in their mind that, boy, Kevin, I can't wait to go on my fast now because this is what I can do according to the word of God. Father, your word declares that they shall be delivered through what? Knowledge. What is this knowledge? Your word. Father, your word declares, but those that resist this knowledge, those that reject it, your word declares that they will and shall be destroyed as a result of a lack of knowledge. Therefore, I plead the blood of Jesus and the whole arm of God over everyone listening to me tonight. I break the bands of wickedness and all forms of the spirit of ignorance and the rulers of the darkness of this world that have been employed by the enemy and deployed by the enemy to keep them ignorant. I pray that that order be broken. I release upon this people a spirit and a hunger after the righteousness of God, because your word declares that they that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled, shall be satisfied. I believe that every spiritual order that they are under, whatever church they are under, that is not speaking, that is not decreeing, that is laughing in the face of your word, that is making a mockery of your word and implementing their own rules, Father, let the Holy Spirit rise up in those people to get out of that place that is taking them on a course to hell. And Father, I pray that you would bring them in an environment that will feed their spirit. Feed them with your spirit food, which is your word. Father, I break the orders and the ordinance and the injunctions that has been levied against them through generations in the past. I pray, Father God, that upon the breaking of that through their discipline and fasting, that you would slingshot, catapult, that you will toss them into their destiny and to place them where they should have been at this point in their lives. I pray for a spirit of humility. I pray that you'd remove out of them that rowdy spirit, that angry spirit, that none of these things will be in them when they now decide to go on their fast, that they will be clear and free, because your word declares in Psalm 66 that if we regard iniquity in our hearts, you will not hear us. And we need you to hear us, Lord. So, Lord, I'm asking you, I am beseeching you on the behalf of this people, that you, O Lord, will intervene and give them the strength, the spiritual and physical strength, the spiritual and physical fortitude to endure the tenure of the fast that the Holy Spirit will instruct them. I pray that their dreams will become vivid, their memory, Father God, shall be blessed, and that they will recall everything that they dream. I pray for the spirit of interpretation, that you, O Lord, will release in them the understanding of the visions and the dreams that you are affording them, to release to them the revelation of the mysteries in their lives. I speak it, I decree it, I declare it, I call it forth and ask it in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, sealing this prayer with your law that says, whatsoever things we desire when we pray, We must believe that we have received it and we shall have it. I believe it, Father God. I believe your word has gone forth on this night to break up so many demonic orders and so many families listening to this program. And by virtue of listening alone, they are blessed. In the matchless and in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen and amen. I thank you for joining me tonight. I am tired. And I am going to my bed because I feel that anointing has been released upon you. And now you shall go forward and obey the commandments of this book, not that person on that pulpit. If they're preaching against this book, you need to leave. If they're going contrary to this book, it's time for you to get out. If they're going contrary to this book, you want to cause the hell. And there's no excuse. The word of God says in this book, anyone who add or take away, curse is anyone that take away or add to this book. This book says in Jeremiah 17:5, curse, you are automatically cursed if you put your trust in man. If your pastor, if your leader, if you see them above your God, then you got a problem, you curse. Read this book. I take my time to break down the scriptures to you to give you an understanding whereby even a child can understand. You have no excuse now. Go forth, praise your God, go on a fast. If you've never been on one before, ask the Holy Spirit. Even if you do one day, try it and work your way up to greater days. And watch these things that this book has promised you as a result of the fast come to pass in your life. I love you. I pray the blessings of the Lord upon you, that God will catapult you into your destiny as long as you obey his law. I release you in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen and amen.